This video is brought to you by Brilliant. About 10 months ago, I did a monitor guide which has gained almost 500,000 views. Since then, I got a ton of questions that led me to believe I should do an updated version. So, in this video, I will cover the monitor basics because the standards have changed and shifted a bit since last time, and I'll also dive into more details as well as what to look for and what to avoid when looking for a decent productivity monitor. I'll end the video with my personal recommendations for specific models and setup scenarios for optimal productivity results. I will leave a link to the previous guide at the end of this video for reference, and with that out of the way, let's get started with aspect ratio. Aside from the popular 16:9, 29:9, and super ultra wides, we now have a new, never before seen aspect ratio of 16:18. This latest LG Ergo monitor broke these standards the last month, and we'll talk about it in a second. In terms of size, the most popular 16:9 ratios come in 24 inches, 27 inches, 32, and quite a few options are now available in around 43 inches. Ultra wides are usually 29, 34, 38, but we often begin to encounter new choices of 40 inches, like the latest 5K 2K display from LG. Super ultra wides are 43 or 49 inch behemoths and are very niche. I know people that use them for productivity, but they don't normally take advantage of the extra width for the most part. Where you'll find more applications for those super ultra wides, however, is when it comes to gaming simulators, where you can take full advantage of the curvature and that extra real estate for the ultimate immersive experience. 16:18 is a new ratio which I'm very eager to try myself, and I will, so stay tuned for that and subscribe. Think of 16:18 like having a vertical dual monitor setup, which to be honest is the more productive way. It takes far less space in this orientation and will give you much smaller footprint on the desk with no horizontal bezel in the middle. If we talk about curvature, that is to be expected from ultra wides and super ultra wides, although not all of them have it. I find it a must for anything wider than 16:9, since at a certain point, toolbar items and UI elements around the edges of the display become too far off center and hard to focus on when the display is flat. A fun fact, if you get used to using a curved ultra wide, you'll definitely need some time to adjust to a flat display, which will look like a fisheye lens. By far, the most popular size among all displays is 27 inches. It is ideal for any type of work and entertainment. It is not too small, not too big for any desk. I find 32 inches, however, to be much better. Working on a 32-inch monitor with great scaling and proper resolution is bliss and reduces eye strain a lot. When using 32 inches, it will be best to think of a monitor arm, however, because most stands are bigger and might take up too much desk space. You can go smaller in size, of course, like 24 inches, but honestly, when it comes to a decent resolution in that size, the choices are slim and it's not worth it. Which brings me to resolution and PPI. The monitor you choose can be as big as the distance that you keep it from your face. What I mean by that is that you can keep a 24-inch iMac a lot closer to your face while feeling perfectly immersed because it has a fantastic 4.5K resolution. On the other hand, you can install a lower resolution 43-inch monitor further away and still have a great experience because it's not too close to count the pixels. This is where PPI or pixel per inch comes into play. Ideally, you want to have a display with a PPI above 110, preferably close to 200. To give you a perspective, the iPhone 13 Pro has 450 PPI. The higher the PPI, the crisper the picture. As another reference, a 27-inch 4K display has a PPI close to 160. Unless you're into very specific features like high refresh rate for gaming, for example, anything below 110 PPI will feel ugly and outdated for a productive workflow. If you have doubts, there are online PPI calculators that you can use, or just ask Google to see if your shortlisted monitor is sharp enough. In simple terms, if you're looking for 27 or 32 inch monitor, look for a 4K display. If you are into ultra wides, 5K 2K resolution will be the optimal. 5K 2K means that the ultra wide is 5K horizontally and 2K vertically, like a stretched out 4K 16:9. 6K and 8K displays are still too niche and expensive to talk about at this time. In terms of panel types, there are four to keep in mind: TN, VA, IPS, and OLED. TN, or twisted pneumatic panels, are the oldest variety of LCD panels, which are still common these days. they are cheap to produce, and they have a very low input lag, which makes them appealing for gamers. However, in terms of viewing angles and image quality, they are disappointing. The most sought after panel is the IPS. It stands for in-plane switching, which is a type of LED or form of LCD display panel technology. IPS panels are characterized as having the best color and viewing angles and produce much higher display quality with better colors and much better viewing angles. Between IPS and TN, there is the VA panel. VA stands for vertical alignment, and some companies like Samsung are actually embracing this panel to deliver great products at an affordable price, like the recently released 4K 32-inch Samsung M8. I am planning on releasing a dedicated review on it soon, by the way, so subscribe to the channel if you're interested to watch it. VA panels are excellent compromise to IPS because they have great contrast and vibrant colors for a reasonable price, but are not as good in terms of viewing angles. Finally, there are the OLED panels, which are the most expensive one. OLED, or organic light emitting diode panels, enjoy excellent viewing angles because the technology is very thin and the pixels are extremely close to the surface. OLEDs are lighter, thinner, and use less energy while boasting extremely low input lag with an incredible response time. Depending on your budget, I suggest you start from VA and go up to IPS. If the budget allows it, OLED is awesome. While on the subject of panel types, let's talk about color gamut. A monitor's color gamut describes a specific range of colors that it can produce. A wider color gamut means that the monitor can display colors more accurately within that color space, or in other words, a more true-to-life image. A wider gamut, such as DCI-P3 or Adobe RGB, delivers extra vibrancy look. On the other side, the sRGB gamut will deliver a more faithful representation of shades. When looking at the specs of a display, look for sRGB accuracy above 90%, and if it supports DCI-P3 above 90 and higher, even better. In terms of refresh rate, most of the productivity monitors come standard with 60 Hz. Even the expensive Apple Pro Display XDR comes with 60 Hz. Things are shifting, however, and the influence in need of the gaming community for higher refresh rate and response time is blending with the productivity sector as time goes by. Now more than ever, you can find an ultra-wide, color-accurate productivity monitor that boasts 75 or 144 Hz refresh rate. But what does that mean? It means smoother performance and overall experience of the monitor itself. Anything above 60 Hz will give you the feeling of working on a faster machine where even the gentlest mouse move will be silky smooth. It is very pleasing to the eye and it's definitely noticeable. Also, a higher refresh rate means a smoother looking screen that's easier on the eyes. Great for people who spend a lot of time in front of a screen. If you're trying to ease your eye strain, a refresh rate of 120 Hz or above is optimal, a trend that we see more and more in smartphones as well. When we talk about connectivity, this is one place to invest in. A monitor with decent I/O will save you cash from having to buy external docks. Look for a monitor that can charge your laptop if you're a laptop user, with a power delivery of at least 60 watts. Even if you use a larger laptop, you can still charge it via USB-C, yet a bit slower. If you do heavy lifting, there are monitor choices that can power a laptop close to 100 watts. USB-C port and USB-A ports are always welcome, especially if some of the ports are on the site and are accessible. If they're not, however, that's not a problem because you can always run a hub that you can just stick on the side of the display. I've done this plenty of times. Don't compromise on a stereo jack too, since you'd want to run decent speakers off of it. If it supports Thunderbolt 3 or 4, even better, since it will most likely be able to daisy chain or connect another monitor to it, or simply hook up a hard drive on the back and enjoy speeds of, let's say, 3000 megabytes per second. When choosing a monitor, try to avoid spending extra on features that cannot possibly be good enough. A great example would be built-in speakers. I have tried a plethora of monitors, almost none of which can be recommended for their sound. Unless it's a very expensive Apple Studio display that is famous for its sound, everything average on the market sounds weird, tiny, and laptop-like. When shopping, don't fall for the marketing lingo of monitors coming with speakers that were tuned by an in-house tuning company. Instead, make sure the monitor has a stereo jack on the back to connect a decent set of speakers. Also, avoid having built-in RGB. RGB advertising on the monitor is not a feature that you'll care about, and it is always something that you can achieve with a greater result on your own. It usually adds to the price or hides a flaw that you wouldn't want to invest in. Now, hardcore gaming monitors are exception, of course, because that's in their DNA. Picking and choosing the right monitor could be intimidating, but Once you understand the fundamentals, the choice suddenly becomes logical. Talking about logic or using limited information to make predictions and choices brings me to Brilliant. Brilliant's logic course helps spot logical fallacies, eliminating the impossible to uncover the truth. For example, using Brilliant's fantastic interactive ways of learning, one can use the three concepts of the process of elimination: adjacency, eliminating extremes, and using contradictions to find the right answer. Just like when shopping for a monitor, you can use these same concepts to identify helpful information, starting from very little. Brilliant is a fantastic tool for learning STEM interactively. It has an ever-growing catalog of math, science, and computer science courses that help you learn concepts by working through them interactively and at your own pace. To get started for free, visit brilliant.org/thisisE or click on the first link in the description below, and the first 200 people will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. Back to monitors. Additional feature that you might benefit from is an ambient sensor for automatic brightness. Adjusting the brightness automatically will reduce the stress on your eyes at night or as the sun goes down, since one might easily get carried away in the work. Built-in power supplies are also something to benefit from, since it will reduce the clutter underneath the desk and make things a lot cleaner. Smart features are optional but welcome as well. I've had monitors with remote controls that can be used for entertainment even if the computer is not connected to it. This is actually an example. So the way I see it, and of course it might be different for you, a single 32-inch monitor is more than enough to crush the daily tasks. If it's a 16:9 and you're using a laptop for a computer, when in need you can always use the laptop as a secondary display. If it's a single monitor setup with an ultra-wide, most likely you wouldn't resort to laptops since you'll have plenty of real estate to work with. If it's a dedicated dual monitor setup, I find the vertical stacking the best. Side-by-side dual setups are a bit distracting for me, since one of the monitors will always be considered primary, and since they're side-by-side, you'll end up working at a weird angle. If it's a vertical stack, you'll have the primary display in front and center and the sidekick on the top where you can throw things depending on the workflow. Much better if you ask me. Triple monitor setups are too much brokery for me, although you might be an Excel guru that might require it. So, you know, at least you'll have a dominant display in the center. To me, the best investment would be a 27-inch or a 32-inch 4K IPS monitor with a color gamut of 100% sRGB and above 95% DCI-P3. If it has 75 or 120 or 144 Hz refresh rate, it will be fantastic, and don't forget the ports. A curved ultrawide with the same specs would be great too. Throw that monitor on a decent monitor arm to clear up the desk and you'll be good to go. Which reminds me, look for a VESA mount option when shopping. So as for my personal recommendations for monitor models, I have six categories: best 16:9, best 21:9, most feature packed, best for color accuracy, best overall, and best budget. Now, I was going to talk about them in this video, but since tech changes so quickly, I thought it's better to link them in the description below and update them as time goes by. This way, no matter when you stumble upon this video, you'll be able to see the more accurate suggestions below. If you enjoyed this video, check out my monitor playlist here and subscribe to the channel. It's been an absolute pleasure. This is E, over and out.